Greetings to you in the precious and holy name of Jesus. We're going to continue our teaching again in this session as we're looking at the benefits of the spiritual mind. We're going to read again from the book of Corinthians, the first epistle of Corinthians, the first book, and from verse 9. As it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love him. But in verse 10 it says, but God has revealed them. In other words, God is not keeping you ignorant of the things that he has prepared for you. Yes, I know the scripture says that eye has not seen, nor ear has heard, nor have entered into the heart of man. It's important for you to know that the mysteries, those things that were mysteries before Jesus came, are no longer mysteries, because it is through Jesus Christ that God has revealed to us his very heart of love for us. So yes, scripture says the eye has not seen, nor ear has heard, now have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love him. Okay? So, your love for God, my love for God, would take me much more deeper in understanding these ones known as mysteries. But they're not mysteries any longer. Because here in verse 10 it says, but God has revealed them to us through his Spirit. Now, this is a huge benefit that you have if you have a spiritual mind. Okay? That's the condition. If I do not have a spiritual mind, I would not be able to understand. I will still be living in ignorance. Okay? And all of these good things that God has prepared and planned for me will remain a mystery. But God has revealed them to me. He has also revealed them to you through his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things. Yes, the deep things of God, even the deep things of God. So the Holy Spirit is a person. Okay, he's not a thing. Okay, never ever relate to him as a thing. He's not a feeling and he's not a wind. He's a person. All right, he knows everything. If you want to know somebody in your life that knows everything, it's the Holy Spirit. He has absolute no ignorance in him. There's everything he knows. So he has full knowledge. But listen to the scripture. It's so powerful and encouraging. But God has revealed them to us through his Spirit, for the Spirit searches all things. Yes. Even the deep things of God. Aren't you glad? I am glad. Because I fellowship with somebody who even knows the deep things of God. For what man knows the things of a man except the spirit of the man which is in him? Alright? So you know what you think. And your spirit on the inside of you knows you the best. So the scripture says, even so, no one knows the things of God except the Spirit of God. Just like your spirit inside of you understands you and knows you. Okay? In the same way, the Spirit of God understands the things of God. In verse 12, now we have received not the spirit of the world. All right? Not the spirit of the world. The spirit of the world is another spirit altogether. But one of those things in the world, mindsets in the world we are dealing with, is called a secular mind. Okay? Not necessarily an evil mind, a secular mind that judges everything from a secular point of view. So now we have received, the scripture says in verse 12, not the spirit of the world, but the spirit who is from God, that we might know the things that have been freely given to us by God. It's important for you to know this. But only the spiritual mind can decode this. So if you want to go into the fullness or live in the overflow, if you want everything that God has laid up for you, you've got to move off from being a person with a secular mind, or even a religious mind is never beneficial to anybody. Only a spiritual mind brings benefit, because the spiritual mind understands the spiritual things. And the Holy Spirit communicates not with a secular mind, it communicates with the spiritual mind. So in order for you to know what God has freely given to you, you've got to move from being a secular-minded person into becoming a spiritually-minded person. And the only way that you can do that is you've got to have to get into the scriptures. You've got to get into the Bible. You've got to read the scriptures. You've got to believe the promises you read there. Of course, equally so, you need to be praying. You need to become a person that must have a fellowship with God. That is what prayer is. Prayer is not a mechanism on its own, powerful on its own. Prayer is dialogue with God. Prayer is fellowship with God. So when you keep your fellowship life with God going strong, which could be your prayer life, it could be your worship life, it could be your thanksgiving life, it could be your praise life. You know, worship, you know, you must understand it's a lifestyle. Okay, it's just not one song that you sing, you know, in a service or whatever. Worship is a lifestyle. Worship comes from deep within you. So whatever it is, we've got to get to the point of having a spiritual mind to understand. So when we get into the Word, all right, into the Scriptures and start to read, and when we spend quality time in fellowship with God through prayer or worship and thanksgiving and praise, you know, these are like altars in our lives. Okay, we got to visit that altars every single day. You know, you got to visit the altar of prayer. Okay, the Bible says that prayer is like an incense going up before God, the praise of the saints. So if you go to the altar of prayer, you know, it's incense. The altar of worship is incense. The altar of praise is incense. The altar of thanksgiving. These four altars are very important in the life of every child of God. Now, why? In this context, is because it helps you maintain a spiritual mind. A secular-minded person wouldn't want to do this. Would be completely disinterested, not interested in doing those things. Now, you meet a lot of people like that, a lot of Christians even. They have no appetite for the Word. They have no appetite to pray, no desire to pray. So even when they attend to a church service, so difficult for them to even sing along, you know, with the worship team. They'd rather just stand there and look, you know, look at the people, and they're just not in it. Why? Because the mind is more in the world. There's nothing exciting to the secular mind in spiritual things. Okay, spiritual things does not excite a secular mind. It is secular things that will excite a secular mind. So a spiritual mind will be excited with spiritual things. So if you're living in the secular world, it's going to be absolutely impossible for you to decode this mystery. What mystery are we talking about? What God has freely given to you. Verse 13, these things we also speak, not in words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Spirit teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual things. See, that is how it operates. That's how the Holy Spirit operates. Okay, so he would compare spiritual things with spiritual things. You know, it's a sad state of affair when we start taking spiritual things and try to decode that, you know, with a secular mind. Give it a secular understanding. In other words, we're removing it from its depth. Because a secular mind is a shallow mind. Okay, a spiritual mind is a deep mind. So we're taking it out of its depth when we start to do that. So verse 13 again, these things we also speak, not in words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Spirit teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual things. He doesn't operate like how a politician would operate. You understand? He has got a level that he operates on, and he will not compromise that. And that level is the depth of God's word, all right, and the deep things of the spirit. So he will compare spiritual things with spiritual things. Obvious, if you're not a spiritually minded person, by now you'd be lost. You would know what in the world is going on. Even if someone come and prophesies, or somebody gives you a word of the Lord, or, you know, someone has got a tongue or an interpretation, you cannot make head or tail of it. You don't know what in the world is going on, because spiritual things can be compared only with spiritual things. But the natural man, in verse 14, but the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him. Nor can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. It's amazing. I mean, this is opened out into the world through social media, through television, and even those news reporters. How they would take something that is so valuable that people with spiritual minds will highly value, something that is so sacred that comes from the word of the Lord, a promise of God, or something. Even the blood of Jesus Christ that was shed for us, even his body that was broken, and all the sacrifices, you know, that he made for us and our lives, because we have a spiritual mind, we benefit from all of the sacrifices he made. But you just give a news reporter to report on that matter, and you see how they would, what they would make it seem. They would take everything out of it, because they cannot, they're not spiritually minded, and they cannot discern things that are spiritual. They'll make everything carnal, or judge it from a secular point of view. Even our gathering, even the fellowship that we have with God, you know, to them, Jesus Christ is an historical figure. But to the spiritual mind, Jesus Christ is the Son of God that has come to set us free. As John said, the Lamb of God has come to take away the sins of the world. So this is important for us to understand. We're living in this world, whether it's a secular mindset, whether there's a carnal mindset, whether it's a religious mindset, and then we are now dealing with a spiritual mind, because that's where the benefits are. All right? So verse 15 says, but he who is spiritual judges all things, yet he himself is not rightly judged by no one. In other words, is not correctly judged by no one. Why? Because he has a spiritual mind. And with a spiritual mind, he judges or analyzes everything. And when a person of a spiritual mind starts to analyze things, there are things that he'll just throw away, because he knows these things have no sense in them. They are just a waste of time. Why? He's not judging this from a secular mind or by what everybody is doing, you know, by the whole big crowd that is being swayed on that, in that direction. No, he's not that kind of man or that kind of woman. They would focus on the things that are spiritual. They are going to analyze what is going on, even right now on the earth. If you analyze what is going on with this pandemic, with this COVID-19, with a spiritual mind, you would realize that this is a demon. It's a demon. It's not just a virus. It's a demon that is attacking and killing people. So only with a spiritual mind, but with a carnal mind or the secular mind, your story will be just the same as it is on TV, that's coming out of every politician's mouth, every professor of health, every scientist. You'll be saying the same things. But it takes a spiritually minded individual to know that we're up against a demon here. A bloodthirsty demon that is out to kill people, to inflict them and kill them prematurely. Of course, we can't take that battle to the secular-minded world. You know, we cannot take that battle to the secular, because they don't know what to do with it. So oftentimes what they do, they would criticize us because we are not on their level. Let me remind you of something. They are not on our level. We understand things they never even heard of yet, because we have a spiritual mind and we judge everything with a spiritual mind. And whatever the conclusion we draw It comes from the heart of God, because the Holy Spirit is the one who is our wisdom giver, all right, and knowledge giver. So in verse 16, it says, "For who has known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him?" What a good question, all right? Who, in other words, who can comprehend the mind of the Lord? Who can comprehend the mind of the Lord in order to tell God what to do? Nobody. Nobody can really do that, because God is God. All right? He knows everything. God is never ignorant about anything. Now, in our fellowship with the Holy Spirit, eventually you too will become like that. In other words, you would start knowing things in the Spirit, because you have a spiritual mind. And you are hanging out with someone who knows all things. You know, when you develop this relationship and this communion with the Holy Spirit, you want to remain with him all the time. You know, when you get out into the world and you meet with your friends and you meet with your workmates and whatever, you know, you realize, then only you would realize how shallow they are. You know, how shallow they are in their words, in their style, in the way they talk, and how they deal with matters in their lives, because you are one step ahead. You are much deeper because you have a spiritual mind. All right? But nobody has the power, all right, to comprehend the mind of God in order to instruct him. But listen to the last part of that verse. He says, but we have the mind of Christ. Isn't that wonderful? Isn't that glorious? Nobody has the power to fully know the mind of the Lord, to comprehend the mind of the Lord. Nobody, no human being on earth has the power to do so. I believe even the angels in heaven cannot even do that. All right? But the conclusion here is, hang on, we do have a spiritual mind, but the spiritual mind we have is the mind of Christ. Okay, it's the mind of Christ. It's a mind that thinks on spiritual things, that is able to discern spiritually. A mind that compares spiritual things with spiritual things. It's very careful not to judge spiritual things, not comparing spiritual things with secular things. It won't make sense. Or take a secular thing and judge it with a spiritual thing. And I have seen this in my life, and you probably have come across this as well. Secular-minded people. I mean, these people are not evil people. Many of them are church-going people. You know, they're very regular church-goers. They're very regular in church, and they really love to go to church and whatever it is, but they still have a very strong secular mind. You know, in the time of an incident that takes place in their lives, the loss of a loved one or something bad that's taking place, and now they want to cling to the Lord. And for that moment, they try their utmost best. I've been in many cases like this, to actually try and discern what God is saying. Because now they want to have a spiritual mind. What is the pastor saying? Or what is this person saying? They're trying to work this out. I've had to answer many, many questions from these secular-minded people. Because all of a sudden, some tragic has struck them in their home, or they lost a beloved, someone has passed away, or something of that nature. And now they're inquiring of a few things. But these people are like, you know, very long as Christians, very long in the church. And somehow they at that point in time, during this situation here, they're trying to just like discern now, and they have no power to do so. They struggle. And I actually pity them for that. Not so much for the loss of the one, especially if that person believed in Jesus Christ. The Bible says all those who believe in him shall be saved. So that person's body is still here, but that person is already gone to Jesus. That spirit of that person is already with Jesus. So I don't actually pity that person more than I pity the one that I'm actually talking to, who is living his or her life in the secular world, but a child of God nevertheless, but living in the secular world, and all of a sudden, during this time of tragedy, they're trying to comprehend spiritual things. They're struggling with it. So I actually pity this individual standing or sitting in front of me asking these questions more than the one that has gone on to be with the Lord. Can you see the sadness in this whole thing? How in the world is that individual going to actually understand those things that God has freely given to them? It's not coming from anywhere else. It's coming from the Holy Spirit. He's the only one who knows it and understands it, and he's the only one that can deliver it to you. So I want to encourage you today, child of God, if you're listening to this message, move away from the secular world. Develop your mind spiritually. Have a life of prayer and worship and praise and thanksgiving. Have some time to sit down with your Bible, you know, on your tablet, on your phone. You can download the app, or you can just get the written word, and you can sit a few minutes with it every day to just read and educate yourself and pray for a few minutes and develop an appetite. Okay, develop a taste for the word. Develop a taste to pray, an appetite to pray, a longing in your heart to talk to God, your Father, who loves you. You know, his love is immeasurable. Nothing in this world can measure his love, and nothing in this world can take you out of his love. You must keep that on your mind. Let's pray. And now, Father, I thank you in the holy name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank you, Lord, for the power of your blood. I thank you for the power of your broken body. I thank you for the power to heal today. So I declare every person that is listening to me, I declare you healed in the name of Jesus. I declare you blessed in the mighty name of the Lord of hosts. I declare you blessed supernaturally in the name of Jesus. And whatever, if there's anything that you are up against at this time, I want you to turn to the Lord, because he's with you. So I ask you, Father, today, may you grant them that breakthrough, even in that situation right now, and let them have a taste, oh God, of a spiritual mind, and have a love for you, oh God, that is never ending. May you bless them even today, my Father. In Jesus' name I pray for every partner, Lord, every person that gives to this ministry, everyone who sows into this ministry. You know, Lord, this is a fertile ground. The Luke Kistan Ministries is a fertile ground. Nobody gives into this ministry and does not be rewarded with an harvest, Lord. So I declare in the holy name of Jesus, my God, that you shall give unto them a hundredfold harvest today in the mighty name of the Lord of hosts, with much thanksgiving, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. May the Lord bless you richly. You can go on our website. You can go to Phoenix Christian Fellowship. That's our website. Or go to Luke Kistan Ministries. And then you would see there's icons there on the first page. And then you can click there if you feel in your heart you need to sow into this ministry. You're under no pressure to do so. You have to have a heart. The Bible says you must determine in your heart if you would want to give. May the Lord bless you richly in Jesus' name. Amen.